Welcome, everyone. Hi, how you doing? Hello. How's everybody doing? Thank you so much for coming tonight. We're very excited to have you here. It's great. So just to give you a little background, a couple years ago we did this this panel that was about the legal challenges in an age of robotics, and we just found we had this really incredible outpouring of people. I mean, actually not quite like this, but close. And it's really got us excited about robotics and artificial intelligence in the law as an area for the law school and for the Center for Internet and Society where I and a lot of us here work. There's just so much energy around this issue, both within industry and in academia. I just want to get a quick show of hands because I'm curious. How many people here are training to be a lawyer or are lawyers? Just a quick show of hands. Okay. So how many people here are in another discipline, computer science, and look at that. Wow, I would say that's probably a majority, which may be like the first time that we've ever had that in an event. Well, welcome to everybody, but we really appreciate you being here. Thanks also to our co-sponsors today, the Stanford Law and Technology Association. We really appreciate it a lot, and the Stanford Technology Law Review, which are student organizations that are frequent partners with Center for Internet Society, and we really appreciate your ability to co-sponsor this as well. So basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the bios real quick, and then I'm going to sit down and kind of ask the questions, kind of presidential campaign style, where I'm Gwen Ifill away from everything, and you're going to focus on the panelists. Thanks very much for coming. So who do we have today? We have some incredible people on this panel today, I have to say. And you need to live up to my claims. So John McGinnis is at Northwestern Law School. He's the author of a wonderful essay called Accelerating AI, Accelerating Artificial Intelligence, which I encourage everyone to read. A very interesting discussion of the repercussions of artificial intelligence going forward, and also a book, Accelerating Democracy, which is forthcoming from Princeton University Press next year, where artificial intelligence is one of several themes. And we're really delighted to have him here today. He also spoke at another conference today as well. Lawrence Solum is at Georgetown Law School. He is obviously, a constitutional scholar, and a lot of people know Larry from his legal theory blog. But one thing you might not know is he wrote a great article. I just overheard Ian talking about this, and I feel the exact same way, called Legal Personhood for Artificial Intelligence. For a lot of us who study artificial intelligence in the law, this is like one of the first articles that got us excited about the space, and I hope we get to talk about it. Ian Kerr holds a Canadian research chair in law, ethics, and technology, which is not a common thing to hold a research chair there. And he's at the University of Ottawa. He brought lots of his students, which is pretty exciting. they're in the middle there, which is really great. We're going to have a nice time with them. And he also actually teaches a course. This is one of the unique places I've ever seen this, which is on law and robotics. So if you're lucky enough to go to school, he teaches a course in that. And then we actually have a person who is not trained as a lawyer, well, actually has some training in law. That's because like 20 degrees, but one of them is law. But we actually have a bona fide person who works in artificial intelligence and innovation. And Marianne Williams, thanks so much for coming all the way from Sydney, Australia to talk to us today. Marianne is the Associate Dean for Research and Development at the entire University of Technology in Sydney, and she also heads up a technology and innovation lab there called the Magic Lab. You should really check out the amazing stuff that they do over there. I'm going to be your moderator. I work at the Center for Internet Society where I direct the robotics research. There's two reasons why I'm qualified to be a moderator of a panel like this, okay? And they're really good. You're going to see they're really good reasons why. So number one is artificial intelligence, the term, was originally devised at my alma mater, Dartmouth College. Now, it was 50 years before I was there, but I went to school at the place where they coined the term artificial intelligence, right? Even stronger than that, my evidence, is that DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Project, its artificial intelligence project right now is called Cognitive Assistant and Learns and Organizes, or Calo. That's not a coincidence. All right. So I'm going to sit down right now and say thanks again to everybody, and we're going to start the program. Okay. thanks. So, all right. So I'm going to start with Mary Ann here, just to help us, help locate us a little bit. And I was hoping that you could talk to us about where we are in artificial intelligence today. What are some of the big challenges that we face in AI? How are those challenges affected your work at the Magic Lab?
Well, I think you mentioned DARPA and initiatives like RoboCup are competitions that force researchers to build integrated robot sort of solutions to fairly well specified problems, even though the problems are very complex. So this is a good place to look for state-of-the-art robots. So I imagine most people at Stanford would be very familiar with the autonomous car and its amazing feats in the desert and in urban environments, and that's really absolutely stunning. And if you go along to RoboCup, which is a global initiative that was actually put forward by the Japanese in the 90s because they were looking to technology to solve their aging population and also their susceptibility to natural disasters. And robotics seemed to be one of the technologies that should be there. But in those days, researchers tended to work on the various components of a robot, but not a fully integrated system. And one of the reasons that we have robots today in our homes, vacuuming the floor, and sort of out and about, is because of these incredible challenges, because they force researchers to actually come up with a real robot doing a real task. Soccer in particular, which is where I have a team that competes in the World Cup robot soccer competition. And we've had a lot of success. We were one of the top teams in 2004 when we won the scientific challenges, and runners-up in 2008. And this particular problem, it turns out to be a fantastic benchmark because it requires not only the design and development of low-level skills like vision. You might be capturing 30 images from your camera a second, also locomotion and localization, like where am I in the world, what direction am I facing, and also very high-level behaviors like passing, strategic decisions around your position as a team, whether you're on attack or on defense. So, I would argue that soccer is a good benchmark to see, how well we're really traveling. And actually, the goal of RoboCup is to have a team of robots that can play against the FIFA World Champions in 2050. So there is this big vision, okay, to have an integrated robot that can really run around and beat humans at such a sophisticated game. So they're going to have to be faster, and they're going to have to be able to cope with all kinds of things, such as deception, which is very important in soccer, not just for diving and pretending you're injured, but also for getting around a player and scoring a goal.
So the flop is the future of artificial intelligence, is how to do that. Yeah. So just to follow up with this a little bit. What are the kinds of things that people that are trying to make breakthroughs in artificial intelligence, like what are the kinds of things that they're running up against? What kinds of problems specifically are they trying to solve, or you and others trying to solve, to move us forward in this area?
So there are lots of challenges, okay? We've come a long way, but there are still a lot of challenges, and most of them aren't surprising. So the first one really is, how do we endow a robot with the ability to make sense of its sensory input from both the outside world, but also his own internal states? It's not enough, for example, to analyze a stream of video that might be coming for his camera. We need to know what configuration the robot's in. Does he have his head on the side? Has he been pushed over in a game? Is he penalizing on the sideline? So, a robot has to have a sense of his own sort of bodily state in order to interpret the input coming from the outside world, okay? So there's enormous work that needs to be done there. That's a non-trivial problem, especially when you then couple that with the need to fuse information from multiple senses, sight, smell, hearing, touch. And we often, when facing these challenges, look to the biological world. So, for example, snakes appear to use their senses in a serial fashion. So they'll use their vision to see and grab a mouse and poison it. The mouse runs away not too far, subsequently dies. Then the snake will use heat detection to find that mouse. And if the snake doesn't find it quickly enough, then it will never find that mouse. And it'll have to go find another mouse if it wants to find food. A cat, on the other hand, is a very sophisticated hunter, and it can fuse its information so much more readily. It's more agile, and it also needs to eat a lot more, okay, to maintain itself as well. Another issue is also not surprising, although probably you may not realize just how important it is, because robotics researchers didn't for a long time, and that is anticipation. It's a very basic thing for us to anticipate, and the hockey player Gretzky famously said that he didn't skate to where the ball, where the puck was, okay? He skated to where it was going to be. And that's a very kind of crucial skill that is very hard to replicate in a robot. So anticipation is not just important for hockey or soccer, but it's needed for every bodily action, okay, especially in a dynamic world. And because there's a lag between our brain and our body, we have to solve that problem as well. Prediction, long-term prediction. So in a soccer game, you know, if the opposition, the goalie, kicks the ball, you know, you want to be where the ball is going to land, and so it's not just what your immediate reaction might suggest, but you may need to actually solve some differential equations to figure that out. But then you have other issues. The ball may be occluded. Your assessment of whether the ball could be intercepted, I mean, that's a big challenge also.
Yeah.
But I think that, you know, we're more interested, I think, in legal aspects. And I think it's reasonable to say that robots today have powers of perception way beyond human level already. I mean, there's no question there. We can build sensors that we don't have ourselves, okay? And we have to visualize the output of those sensors in some way that makes sense to us, all right? But without some of the other skills, like a theory of mind or a sense of empathy, which is very related to your body. So one of the ways that we sort of reason about other people's feelings is because we kind of introspect to ourselves. We know what pain feels like, so we see somebody grimace after they've been hit by something, we can more or less, you know, we feel sorry for them. We know what that feels like. But robots won't have that, and that's a massive challenge. And so what does that mean? It means robots could be, you know, suffer all kinds of disorders, autism. They may not show remorse. They may suffer hallucinations simply because of their perceptual power, attention deficiency, all of those sorts of problems. You know, you could diagnose in robots today.
So this is so interesting to me. I mean, it sounds like if our goal is to reproduce a person, an embodied person, right, a human being in a sense, there's a huge disconnect, a big gap between where we are today and the kinds of things we have to solve. But one of the interesting things about the law is that the law doesn't require that you're a person exactly, right? And so there's all kinds of interesting duties and things that you can discharge and the like that don't necessarily require that you have the ability to show empathy or anticipate where a hockey puck is going to be. So I want to switch gears a tiny bit and ask Larry a follow-up question. I mean, Larry, even a few years ago this was, you know, gosh, I mean, it was, what, in the mid-90s, right, you were writing about this. You thought that an artificial intelligence was far enough along that maybe, if we thought about it the right way, it might be able to serve certain functions in the law. So talk a little bit. What's the difference between, you know, the idea of a person, the idea of constructing an actual person, emulating a person, and then versus, you know, emulating a legal entity? How are those different?
Yeah, it was almost 20 years ago that I wrote this article, Legal Personhood for Artificial Intelligences. And so, you know, we sort of have these science fiction images of an artificial intelligence that would be human-like, right? One of the thrills of writing this article was I used fiction in the article, and I got a lovely letter. I used an excerpt from Arthur C. Clarke's 2001, A Space Odyssey, and then I sent him a reprint, expecting it to disappear into some pile of things on his desk. But he actually read it, so I have this lovely letter from Arthur C. Clarke. And you remember Hal, right, Dave? What are you doing, Dave? Right? Or, some of you may remember Heinlein's Mood is a Harsh Mistress, a novel about the singularity. There are lovely fictional depictions of artificial intelligences in Neuromancer, right? The wonderful cyberpunk novel. And I wanted to look at this in a much more practical way. So my question was not, can we imagine an artificial intelligence that would have the right to vote? That's an interesting question, but right now that is a science fiction question. So I thought we should be asking simpler questions about legal capacities, aspects of legal personhood that we can imagine artificial intelligences within sort of the foreseeable future actually performing. Well, one of those has come, is real today, right? So one of the capacities that humans have is the capacity to drive an automobile. And in order to drive an automobile, you have to get a driver's license. So one question could we ask is, could an artificial intelligence get a driver's license? And of course, the state of Nevada has just passed a statute. We have a research here at Stanford, right? Legal research on this problem. State of Nevada has just passed a statute that sort of contemplates artificial intelligences, that is, autonomous automobiles that would drive themselves. And I'm told that we're not very many years away from a commercial vehicle, a vehicle you can buy, and that will drive itself. The example, I didn't use that example in my article 20 years ago. I used the example of a trustee. Right, so trustees have to be able to, someone who administers a trust has to be able to do certain things. They have to be able to follow some instructions. They have to be able to invest trust assets. They have to be able to distribute the assets of the trust in various ways according to a set of rules. Well, those are tasks that it's imaginable an artificial intelligence could perform. And then the question is, well, under what circumstances would the law permit an artificially intelligent system to fulfill this legal role of trustee?
Right? Yeah, what are those considerations? I mean, what if you're a policymaker, a lawmaker, and you're trying to decide, and also there's an optics factor here, right? I mean, the idea is that not everybody will necessarily be comfortable with an artificial intelligence being a trustee for their work. What are the kinds of considerations you're looking at?
Yeah, so you can sort of imagine how it would go. In the beginning, the reaction of the legal system, sort of legal systems are very conservative things, really, would be, that's ridiculous, right? An artificial intelligence can't possibly be a trustee. A human being could use an artificially intelligent system. You could even draft a trust instrument that would direct the human to follow the advice of the artificially intelligent system, but you couldn't have an artificially intelligent system serve as a trustee. But suppose we have the following scenario. Humans screw up, right? They screw up in all kinds of ways. Human trustees steal from the trust, right? Human trustees disregard the terms of the trust. Human trustees sometimes make horrendously bad investment decisions. And we can imagine someone sort of saying, I really want the artificial intelligence to be the trustee, right? And what would we require? What we would require is functional capacities, just as we require in the driving case, right? We're going to let artificially autonomous cars function without human intervention or supervision if they do a good enough job driving the car. And likewise, we would allow an artificial intelligence to serve as a trustee if it could do as good a job or better. Probably we would require that they be better, right, before we'd actually get serious right. about this. If they could do a better job than humans can do.
Let me push back on this a little bit, though, right, because this is interesting. So Marianne could program a robot to go in and vote. I'm probably using criteria that are better than a lot of voters actually use when they go into the voting booth, right? So, you know, talk me through how functional capacity works there, right? So artificial intelligence has the functional capacity to vote, but we wouldn't want to say that they're allowed to do that. I mean, is there a way to sort what kinds of tasks it's okay to only ask the basic functional questions about? And then when do we get into a territory where we're talking about not merely ability physically to do it, but some other consideration?
Yeah, so now we're sort of, clearly it wouldn't be enough just to be able to go into the voting booth, right, and vote for someone, even if we liked the way that robots voted, right? that wouldn't be enough. We wouldn't let them vote just because they could pull the lever or punch the hole or push a button or touch a touch screen. Something more would be required there. Voting has to do with our images of citizenship. And so we're starting to get into the realm not of the kind of legal personhood that would be relevant to being a trustee or a driver. We're talking about the connection between legal personhood and moral personhood, right? The right to vote is connected with our moral status. And that raises a really deep question. It's a question of moral philosophy, right? And that is, what is it about humans that makes us think that they need to have the right to vote and all kinds of other rights as well, a whole bundle of rights. We associate these with constitutional rights. But it's more than that. It's the way we morally treat other persons. Right? So here's a thought experiment for you. It's an Aussie thought experiment. It was come up with, the guy who came up with this is David Chalmers, and he's a very well-known philosopher of mind at ANU, at Australian National University. And so his thought experiment involves what he calls zombies. But philosophical zombies aren't like the ones on television or in Night of the Living Dead. Here's what a philosophical zombie is. A philosophical zombie is someone who behaves exactly as a human behaves, right? So everything is the same. If I were a philosophical zombie, I would be talking just like I'm talking now. But
it makes you think.
But there's a crucial difference. Philosophical zombies have no consciousness. That is, they have no qualia. They don't experience their own mental life. So they were like robots, right? All the neurons are firing, right, in exactly the same way, but consciousness doesn't attach. So if you can imagine zombies, right, the question would be, would they have the right to vote? Well, of course they would. They would be indistinguishable from you or I, and they would demand the right to vote. If we somehow said, you might be a zombie, you can't vote, they would say, what do you mean? Of course I can vote. I'm a human being. Right? They're just like us. They're just like us. They behave exactly the same way. Right? Now imagine a robot, right, that, now this is the science fiction part, that has the functional capacities that lead humans to demand the right to vote. The functional characteristics. Right? Now, this is a science fiction robot, not a robot that's going to be invented 5 years from now or 10 years from now. Who knows what the time frame might be, and maybe never. But if there were such a robot, one with the same functional capacities as humans, I find it hard to believe that we would deny them the right to vote.
So, I mean, this is a rabbit hole we can't afford to go down in a small session, but I mean, it's fascinating stuff. I want to rein us in a tiny bit for now and talk about the fact that it doesn't require a philosophical zombie for people to react as though they're really in engaging with a human being, right? And so, for instance, you see like charity games where you play a game with a computer where you have to donate a certain amount of money or whatever it might be, and you put a robot in the room, just a normal everyday robot that was built today that's not even moving around, and people are more charitable because they think the robot is judging them, right? And so there's this really interesting work by B.J. Fogg here at Stanford University in the communications department, where he talks about the fact that, look, computers can avail themselves of all the same advantages as people in terms of our reactions to people. So for instance, we'll reciprocate, we'll cooperate, we'll respond to flattery. And this is something that Ian and I have both explored, and so I wanted to maybe move on for a moment to Ian and ask this question of, given the fact that we're so, I don't know if the right word is hardwired to react to anthropomorphic machines, things that just behave like people as though they're really people, what sort of challenges does that create for society and law, in your view?
Sure, and I'd love to pick up on this by sort of carrying forward a little bit.
Please.
Without going down the rabbit hole with Larry's example, but sort of inverting it in a kind of way, asking who the zombie is, in a sense, because I think that there is ample evidence, both empirically, but also we can avail to popular culture to think about some of these examples, too, to make the point that I think you were hinting at there, Ryan, which is that I don't think we have to wait to have concerns about some of the things that Larry was talking about until science fiction delivers on the philosophical zombie. And that is precisely because, as you say, we are very, very willing as people to imbue personality in machine systems. And that's something that's been known for a long time. That's been something that people have been thinking about at least since Joe Weizenbaum wrote the program ELIZA and people started chatting with chatterbots. It was something that Sherry Turkle and others have picked up on in developing a field called human-computer interaction. And one of the things that I've been very interested in watching and tracking is the extent to which as Weizenbaum warned us, people really want to imbue personality into the machines. More so than, for example, if we were to sort of force them to take on this science fiction scenario. We don't need that. So a good example, perhaps, might be to talk a little bit about some of the things we've seen in the last couple of years in the fields robotics and AI in popular culture. The one that springs to mind, we haven't talked about it yet, but is Watson, who many people in the room will know as IBM's avatar that went along with a machine system which wanted to play Jeopardy. And of course, this smacks of the sort of things that we've been talking about, which is, we haven't mentioned this either, but it sort of all stems back to Turing and the idea that when we get to the point where there is such functional equivalence or capacity that humans are indistinguishable from the machine systems, that for Turing was sufficient for the purposes of his operational notion of intelligence. But what I think is really interesting to focus on and think about with the Watson example, is how willing and inviting people were to actually personify that machine. And so how many people in the room sort of saw that Jeopardy match? How many people were rooting for Watson? just to sort
it's
of take you back
a skewed sample, Ian.
Yeah, that's right. It is a skewed sample, I'm sure. I've got a couple of short clips, one-minute clips, just to put us back in the mind frame and for those who didn't have a chance to see it. And if it's okay, after we play the clip, I'd love to just say a few things that follow up on the point that you asked me about.
Yeah, sure. Sounds good. And then I want to ask you, Marianne, a little bit about whether this really is a sea change, whether IBM's Watson's really different from what came before it. But we'll put
which
we'll
I'll
put
also in comment on in a probably different way than Marianne.
Fair enough.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want to go with one or two?
Let's go with one for starters, just to remind people of that scene where Watson just cleaned up the human beings.
By the way, I was rooting for the humans. I always go for the underdog.
Yeah.
All the way down at 2,000.
It's just acne. You don't have this skin infection, also known as Hansen's disease. Watson.
What is leprosy?
You are right.
Attitude brute for 1,600.
Music fans wax rhapsodic about this Hungarian's transcendental etudes. Watson.
Who is Franz Liszt?
You are right.
What is dengue fever?
Dengue fever, correct.
What is violin?
Good.
Who is Rachmaninoff?
Rachmaninoff is correct.
What is albinism?
Good.
Cambridge for 1,600.
Answer, Daily Double. What are you going to wager?
I'll wager $6,435.
I won't ask. I won't ask. Here's the clue for you, Watson. The chapels at Pembroke and Emmanuel Colleges were designed by this architect.
Who is Sir Christopher Wren?
You are right, and that adds to your total.
So that's an edited and shortened sequence of a chain of questions in a row where Watson just boom, boom, boom. And I dare say the humans looked a bit robotic in that scene. And that was one of the things was quite telling while all of this was going on. And so everybody knows the aftermath of that, and I do want to actually hope we get a chance to talk about how IBM has marketed this and what they want to do with these kinds of systems and what they've been doing since. But I think it's important because very few people, to me, both in the blogosphere and people I talk to, sort of paid much attention to the fact that although Watson as a machine system doing the question and answer part, you know, being able to find the answer, do the algorithm, and get answers to the question was impressive, at least to people who don't actually code these things and work in the field. What most people forget about, okay, yeah. What most people I think don't remember or think about or recollect is, of course, this is entirely a fiction, what's going on here. I'm not referring to the speed at which Watson can run its algorithm. I'm referring to the fact that Watson was playing Jeopardy. Of course, Watson was not playing Jeopardy because Watson doesn't know how to play. Watson doesn't know how to play because Watson doesn't know how to do this thing that's called taking turns. And so while there was a fairness in the system that was set up in terms of, although some people I think were writing about this, about whether the buzzer system anchored towards the machine. But one of the things that obviously had to happen here, and you're seduced into not thinking about this, this becomes practically invisible in the context of what's going on here, is that Watson had to be cued when to know to take the next turn, when to answer to Alex Trebek about the Daily Double, because Watson doesn't know how to take turns. And Watson doesn't know what it means to do these things. I'm not suggesting that those things couldn't be learned by machine systems, and maybe that's part of what Larry's getting to when he's saying some of this stuff in terms of functional capacity and equivalence of actually seeming more like a human being is far off into the future. But what's more important to me is the fictionalization of why this all happened. And that is, I have another clip on it, I don't know if you feel like we have enough time to spend on that, but in any event, it's the IBM promo stuff about what they want to do with it. It's about a 1 minute clip.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, if we can.
So while that's being set up, I'll just sort of speak to it briefly in advance of it. And in essence, what I want to suggest here, and I'd be love it if there was some discussion back on this point, feel free to push back on me, is that what the strategy here is with IBM in pushing and promoting a system like Watson, which is a machine system with an avatar attached to it, is that there is an entire layer of trust that is somehow projected onto Watson through playing with Alex Trebek, having the scenario where Alex Trebek has the little quick witty comment back, and having this whole thing take place in the context of a popular culture game that's on national television. Then, all of a sudden, IBM's in a position to say, hey, well, if you think Watson's pretty good at natural language in the context of Jeopardy, wait till you see what it can do to the medical field. So cue to play the tape.
While it's playing the game show Jeopardy as its test case, there are lots of other domains where people want questions answered. Healthcare is certainly one of those places. Suppose you're a clinician, a doctor, a nurse trying to diagnose a very complex case. You have some ideas, but in order to confirm your hypothesis, you need a lot of information.
The amount of valid, useful information that will make a difference in a patient's life, it just has exploded to the extent that it's impossible to keep up with that. So we need tools that glean the best of that. And most of the data, if you will, on how a patient's doing is in natural language, not coded data. And I think that plays to the strength of Watson.
In seconds, doctors everywhere in the world are going to be able to find out what are the best treatments and how do I ensure best outcomes. That's just one example of how we hope to revolutionize entire industries with this new capability.
Business people would say we can make things more productive, more efficient, more optimized. Others would say we can address some real societal issues.
It's limitless, the number of things you could potentially apply this to.
And it changes What's the paradigm this, Ian? This in looks which we work with computers.
I can't wait for this future that Watson's going to bring.
Life is really about questions and answers.
Are you trying to jam your thumb in the door of progress here, or what's going
Absolutely.
On?
Absolutely.
Okay.
For sure, sure. I have...
You invited us to push back, right?
Yeah. Sure. I'm going to push back now.
Your theory is a great theory. It happens to be 180 degrees wrong. If you listen to the guys who actually did it, what happened was the management, this is an AI research team working in natural big, large knowledge bases. The management came to them and said, we want something spectacular like a driverless car that went across the desert. What can you guys do? And nobody really knew until, and they were having this dinner at some restaurant, and Jeopardy was up on the screen. And someone made the inference, made the inference that, oh, hey, maybe we can do that. And then it was only after the fact that IBM said, oh, you know, well, we have to explain to the shareholders and why we're doing this. Well, they had 25 people on the team, and it was very expensive. And so they invented this medical thing after the fact.
That's interesting. That's not mutually exclusive of what you're saying, right?
So
that's interesting. That's great.
That
I didn't know that
point.
Background, personally.
In many ways, that makes part of my point for me. Part of what I wanted to get at here is first of all, so starting from the point that because the Watson system had no sensory devices to be able to hear when and needed to be cued in all of this, this was a staged event. But certainly the point of this, as was the point of trying to crack the natural language, was an attempt to get closer to making those kinds of systems look more human in the way that they solve problems. And I don't really care, you know, which came first in terms of their business plan. The point is that they've since carried forward an elaborate business plan, which has moved forward even since then, the point of which is to ultimately have us delegate important human responsibility to machine systems, tying this to this sort of popular culture event that makes us feel good about all these great things that it can do. So what I'm really interested in thinking about here is how willing we are to sort of go down, partway down the trust road in terms of thinking, well, if Watson can win at Jeopardy, of course I want him to help my doctor as he's doing a diagnostics. But to answer your question really briefly, Ryan, so that other people can get into the conversation, I guess I have the same set of concerns that Isaac Asimov had when he wrote one of the famous short stories in his collections called The Inevitable Conflict. For those of you who don't know the story, it's worth just me saying one shred about it. First of all, just as a tidbit, when I teach this story to my students, 95% of them mistakenly later call it the inevitable conflict, which undermines the point of what Asimov was trying to do. But he imagines a world in which we'd start to take Watson and the Watson machine systems and start delegating out you know, maybe first to the medical profession, then maybe economics and the financial institutions, and further and further to the point where the machines run the world economy. They're not already doing that. But in any event, the reason for getting the machines to do this was to try to get help at cracking what were the intractable, inevitable things about the human condition: war, insecurity, strife, poverty, things like that. And what's kind of beautiful in the moral of the story is that we ultimately learn at the end of the day that the humans were concerned that the machines were making mistakes, and it turned out all along that the machines made those mistakes because they knew the humans would be concerned about making the mistakes, so that they righted the humans' corrections of the machines themselves. And at the end of the day, what we come to learn is that all of the things that were said to be inevitable, the war, strife, things like that, which the computers and the machines then went on to solve, we learned that those were evitable. But what became inevitable in the story was our delegation, our seduction, our willingness to delegate to the machines all of these human properties and concerns.
So it's a slippery, I'm going to, we have to change topics a little bit here to make sure we can cover all our bases tonight. But it's a slippery slope, right? So one day we're using it to play Jeopardy. Aha, it's so fun. We're willing to buy this conceit. The next thing we know, we're turning it over diagnoses. And then if we're to believe Betsy Cooper, a law student at Yale who just wrote in the Yale Law Journal that we can use Watson in order to do interpret legal texts better than the new textualists and even imagine that we can. And then all of a sudden we live in this world where we're sort of relying on this crutch. Is that the dystopian vision that you have in mind?
Well, yes, and it's not so much that I wish to present a dystopian vision or a slippery slope argument, as much as I want to sort of remind people that in fact it's not just the case that the science fiction is the thing we're waiting for to happen. We already play a role in fictionalizing the way we think about our interactions with machine systems. You started with the great example of the computer being in the room as to do oversight.
Right.
And so it's more just making that observational point than it is to try to push, you know, some big dystopian vision that I say these things.
Right. Right. No, I'm purposely overstating. So I mean, let me do this. I mean, first of all, I'd love to hear from you, Marianne, about whether Watson's Much Ado About Nothing. I mean, is this really different in kind, this stuff, or is it qualitatively different, or is it just quantitatively different? Is it just more horsepower, or something interesting and new going on?
Yeah, evolution, revolution. It's always up to us.
Right, yeah.
Well, I think you did raise a very interesting question, and something that I have now changed my view on, and that is, do we really need these systems to know what they're doing? Do we really need an autonomous car to know that it's driving, that it has passengers, that there are, you know, when robots play soccer, do they need to know they're playing soccer? And a year or so ago, we set up a game where we had autonomous mobile robots against remote control robots, the same body. And the autonomous robots won hands down, even against the people who designed them. So that was sort of surprising in terms of what could actually be achieved. And even in the way that we explain our own consciousness and our own actions, you know, they make sense to us in our little world that we create in our own minds, but maybe it is just a chemical reaction, which is kind of what you're alluding to, in the sense that we might be driven by what gets our attention or something pretty and shiny. And so I think it's not obvious, and even the experts can't tell us. I mean, we do know that nothing is what it seems, that's certain. You know, what you see in front of you, it feels like it's a 3D movie that you're embedded in. It's all a creation of your mind. There is no color in the world, and yet, you know, we create it here as if we're sitting in a movie theater. And that idea of consciousness has been totally and utterly debunked. I mean, from the way that our mind works and things like that. So in terms of the question, though, what about Watson? So a precursor to Watson was, of course, Deep Blue. So in 1997, Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov. And Garry Kasparov said he could smell intelligence on the other side of the board. Now, I think in a way it passed the Turing test because probably all Garry Kasparov ever thought about was chess, and so it was the ultimate. But the challenge of chess is very different in terms of complexity. You know, it's a board, it's a stable environment, it's a known environment, and there are only a certain number of legal moves. So solving that problem is a lot easier. And I think the kind of breakthrough, if you could call it that, with Watson is this hybrid design where it's able to, you know, run algorithms on a lot of different sort of using different techniques and to be able to aggregate and then use, you know, confidence factors to figure out what is the best guess. And I mean, that's kind of something we often do as well. And we sometimes take advice from experts or from family members just to get different perspectives. And that does help us make decisions. So for the Jeopardy challenge, Watson used something called deep QA, which is a massively parallel probabilistic kind of reasoner. And you know, one of the hard things in AI is bringing things together. It's very easy to sort of solve a problem in a narrow domain, but kind of to bring things together on the fly, I think was, you know, something quite new. And if you marry something like Watson with an autonomous car, such that you could ask it questions about what happened in that accident, why did it go through that red light? And I think that people who work in AI believe that that day is closer now. Largely because many people, I think, expected the solution to that problem not to come from those methods, but to come from a more top-down rationalist approach. Because surely you need to have meaning to figure out language. But Google has shown through its language translation and other kinds of features and services that that's just not true. And what is truly amazing about these techniques is they're scalable. So the bigger it gets, the better the performance. Mm. And I think that gives a lot of people hope. And it's also something we don't quite understand.
So it gives a lot of people hope. I think probably it scares some people too. So let me let me table this discussion right now and move on a little bit to what about, it's the future, and we're getting really good at this stuff. And it's not just that we can do domain-specific things like answer Jeopardy questions or help a doctor, which Ian is against doing, just kidding. But actually, we start to get in a situation where artificial intelligence becomes quite powerful. And so my question is for John. And John, I'm going to ask you to look ahead to that moment where we start to get closer to this notion of not just artificial intelligence that tricks us into believing that it's a person, or artificial intelligence that does enough under the law to be able to qualify, but something that truly sort of approaches a sort of strong AI. You know, is there going to come a time when you know, there's going to have to be a government policy toward the deployment of AI, do you think? And what should that be?
Well, I think that there might actually need to be a policy now. And let me string together two of the last comments, one about voting and the other about Watson. I mean, voting in a democracy is, one, it's about counting preferences. And we might not think a computer or an AI should be involved in that at all. But democracy is also about predicting what our policies are going to do. We have preferences, but we notice that our politicians claim, and sometimes they claim the same things are going to come from policy A and policy B. And we have to decide, actually, whether this is actually going to be a good instrument. Something like Watson and AI in general is a part of that process now of gaining information and helping us evaluate policy. So that, I think, is going to be a very important aspect of AI. And if it is in gathering data and running simulations, it's a real public good. It may be underproduced today. What I mean by a public good is something is something that we all enjoy. We all enjoy defense, things of that sort. And yet, we're not quite sure sometimes of how best to produce them. And so information is, in some sense, the master public good of democracy. And AI, oddly enough, I think fits into that much better than any other kind of technologies, particularly because technologies from a long time ago, energy-intensive machines caused global warming, have been causing all, might cause all these other problems for humans, and we need to have adjuncts and helps to evaluate these, particularly if they're going faster and faster. So that's one of the reasons that I think already you might think we underinvest in AI because of the help that it will give in establishing general policies. That's even before your reference to the threat we might fear from AI, that at some point, and this is obviously, this audience will, I'm sure, know the famous article by Bill Joy, "The Future Doesn't Need Us," the idea that computers may take over, we will not be able to master the master machines. And his recommendation for policy is a kind of relinquishment. We should simply relinquish these machines. I think that is an impossibility, particularly an impossibility in a world of competing military sovereigns. You referred in your beginning of your remarks to DARPA. DARPA, of course, is our defense agency, and it's very concerned with generating artificial intelligence on the battlefield, and that's the history of technology. It's always connected to sovereigns attempting to get advantages. So the idea that any nation is going to relinquish research into AI seems to me to be a fantasy, maybe worse than a fantasy, because then the worst nations will never relinquish it. So what does that mean about our policy? I think that also points to the same kind of government involvement in one way or another in encouraging what has been called in the literature a kind of friendly AI. Because I think it's a mistake, and this may go to some previous comments on the panel, to too much anthropomorphize AI. It's not clear that artificial intelligence has to develop with the kind of will to power that is characteristic of man, because that will to power may itself be a product of biological evolution, that man, humans, like most other creatures, like all other creatures, are somewhat programmed to consider their welfare to the exclusion, to one degree or another, of the welfare of other animals. And you might think that AI is not going to come from exactly that kind of process, or at least it doesn't necessarily have to come from that process. If that's true, what we should be very concerned about through the threat as well is the development of a friendly AI, because that will, in turn, be the best adjunct to help us predict the policies to prevent an unfriendly AI. And so all of this suggests that that AI is really a great public good that we really need to think about how to encourage, and encourage in ways that is going to be friendly to humanity. And I think that the Watson, development of Watson suggests already that it can be a useful adjunct in helping us simulate things that will help public policy, and it may suggest that the progress is sufficient, or at least there's a possibility of sufficient progress, that the idea that we could get some kind of unfriendly AI, particularly from some military research into it, is sufficient, that the government should start considering how we can have a project to project a more friendly AI.
So the spiral that I guess I would be concerned with, and I'm going to pose this question to you, John, and then I'd love to get your views as well, Larry, on this, is the idea is that it turns out that will to power template model is a really good one, and that we discover that artificial intelligence, to make it the most powerful it can be, needs to be able to select its own survival as against other factors, right? So you get this sort of recreation of the same forces that evolutionarily are behind, ostensibly behind human evolution. And so the United States decides that because Iran, China, whoever, has gone down this road and are generating very, very powerful AI, then we also need to do the same thing. And so it becomes this arms race, and you kind of take this dark route toward ever more powerful artificial intelligence. And so I guess my question for you first, and then to Larry, and then everybody else should weigh in as they want. Are we ever going to face a kind of Manhattan Project for artificial intelligence, where we're building something that we're actually not comfortable with, and we're doing it because we're concerned that the other guy's going to do it if we don't?
I think the Manhattan Project should be one in friendly AI, because I think the AI, the idea...
A friendly Manhattan Project.
The alternative, I think...
That's like Chicago Project, or the...
The alternative, I think, is quite dangerous. That's the advantage of friendly AI, right? The computational power, at least, doesn't seem to me to be necessarily connected to the will to power. And so long as we're ahead in friendly AI, we have the best opportunity to have a powerful adjunct to help us predict the right policies to defend ourselves and to reach a good result. So that I do think of a Manhattan Project, but without necessarily the military connotation that has. That said, I don't see any alternative for the United States, and there has been discussion of this in the literature, of using computation on the battlefield. I mean, the alternative, I think, is to give it over to less well-meaning nations. I think the United States, actually, as the world's hegemon, in some sense, has the greatest interest in the peace and prosperity of the world, and it's a democratic nation as well. And so I think it'd be a great mistake to give that up. But I don't think that's the kind of Manhattan Project or the kind of focus I would put most of our government money or government prizes or however we would think it's best to structure this, because I think that in itself is an interesting question about how you incentivize technology today, whether it's through some sort of prize system or subsidies.
Right, so actually, Larry, I'll give you a choice of questions to answer if you don't mind. So one of them is this version where we're worried about another country because we're a sovereign nation. Another is a market, same picture and sort of, but a market version of it, where you're doing something and you decide that you're going to use artificial intelligence to be a trustee, to be a board member, to be whatever else, because you believe you're going to get an edge over a competitor. And then your competitor starts to do the same thing, and then soon enough, nobody's at the helm because you're competing. And so, I mean, do you see that as a possibility if it turns out that, again, under your own formulation, artificial intelligence enters the picture when it's better, not just as good, but better than the human being at accomplishing the job? So the legal recognition occurs when it's better than the human, but that also seems to create a picture where, well, then every time that market forces are going to lead us to replace the person with the artificial intelligence, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so let's focus on the sort of the corporate scenario.
Sure.
And I must say, I'm just a little bit, we've gotten into territory that makes me just a little bit uncomfortable.
But why?
Because I feel like we're so outrunning the current state of the technology that we're to some extent really talking science fiction.
Well, let me
run with it. And so, if you bought the idea that an artificial intelligence could be a trustee, of course, trustees have a very sort of narrow set of decisions to make. So, but take that one step further, and suppose that we decided that we could replace the management of a corporation with an artificial intelligence. Well, that's a science fiction scenario, but suppose we're there at some point in the distant or not too distant future. How would we think about the social how would you program in social responsibility? I mean, we have corporations now that do absolutely horrendous things, right? And we're all familiar with the ways in which a human board of trustees and a human CEO can go wrong, right? So, if you're thinking about the scenario, you might think about, well, what would it mean for an artificial intelligence to make morally appropriate decisions? And I just think that's such a deep and difficult, question, because we don't have an answer to that question that we agree upon for humans. We don't agree with each other about this question, right? So how would we approach this question if we were looking at it as a question is, how do you make an artificially intelligent system with power to affect humans act in a morally appropriate way? And I really think that there would just, we don't have a good handle on that. You think about Asimov's iRobot series, right, and the three laws of robotics, right? So this is an attempt sort of to come up with a simple set of rules, right? But of course, any set of rules like that just would not be adequate to the task. Right, and so I think that these are just, even assuming it's friendly AI, right? The question is, what is friendly? And there are trade-offs, and there are very different views about what sort of morally appropriate uses of power are.
Hmm. I mean, I guess I think people probably are eager to start to ask questions. They a lot of hands just going up right now. So I think I'm going to stop it right now and ask you guys to do questions. Now, a couple things to bear in mind. It'd be great if you could approach these microphones, and also bear in mind that, and we'll just alternate. We'll go back and forth, whoever's on this microphone, then whoever's on that one. Bear in mind that you're being recorded and streamed live both, so you can't mess up, and it's also going to be here for posterity. So your questions better be awesome. I'm sick of hearing myself ask questions, but I think that this diverse audience has so many interesting perspectives. It's worthwhile bringing them in immediately. So thanks for your answers so far, and let's start with you, Carl. Yeah.
Sad to relate, I think the most likely scenario is that we're going back to a Cold War scenario, only now for electronic warfare as opposed to nuclear warfare. And just as now the ultimate defense is massive assured destruction, very unfortunate acronym, which is guaranteed by submarines underneath the ocean, the in electronic warfare, it's a team of cyber warriors in a Faraday cage. Because part of electronic warfare is going to be these electronic pulses, which come down and destroy all the electronic components. And so I think it'll be the case that almost any state will have the capability, given our limited defenses, to destroy any other state. And the only real thing you can do is massive retaliate to try to prevent the initial offensive. And that this is far most likely the scenario that we're moving into. It's already happened when Russia attacked Georgia electronically in the last war that they have happened. There have been several other attacks like that, so we have a few prototypes going on, and it's just going to escalate. Sad to relate.
I mean, I think that, you talk about some of these things, John, and, this possibility. I mean, do you think it's possible for government to foster the kind of AI that can prevent the scenario that Carl raises?
I'm certainly not technically capable of saying that it is. Mm-hmm. I certainly think I'm sure that our government is trying to do that at the moment. Throughout the history of warfare, there have always been defenses to offenses, and I think that you will see some defensive moves like that. But I certainly understand that one of the concerns about not only artificial intelligence, but technological acceleration generally, is they may allow all sorts of weaponry much more dispersed than simply through a few countries like Russia and the United States in the Cold War, which is actually, in some sense, much easier to handle because there was mutual assured destruction between two nations and not a multipolar world. So I think there are great dangers in this respect, but I don't think those dangers only come from artificial intelligence. They come from the acceleration of technology generally, from bioweapons to cyber hacking to all sorts of things of that sort.
So yeah. Ian, and then we'll go to the next question. Yeah.
Yeah. Just a quick point, which was actually, John, you made this point in your paper, but it's sort of lost in thinking about Manhattan projects and Cold Wars, which is that one of the things that Bill Joy in his famous paper was worried about, in fact, was that this set of technologies is different in at least one respect. Namely, that these are the sorts of technologies that can be advanced in somebody's garage and don't require these nation states and centralized systems to do that. So just pointing that out, that that's not, you know, the only scenario that we can imagine or the only one that we should have to try to prepare ourselves against.
Mm. Yeah. So it seems like one of the major challenges going forward with AI and far as commercial applicability would be the legal issue of liability. So like right now, if I crash my car into somebody, it's not Toyota's problem, it's my problem. But if you have a self-driving car, that it would seem to be much more the case that it's going to be the automaker's problem. So is there any precedent right now as far as what liability is and as far as these autonomous systems go? Is that going to be an obstacle for the commercial development of these problems? What can you say about that?
I see the roboticist in the room going, yeah, I want to know about that. Come on, you're lawyers. You've got to be able to.
The only thing I would say, and I'll let my other colleagues speak, I don't think it's quite correct that always if your car crashes, it's your problem. Sometimes it is Toyota's problem, and I think there'd be the same kind of division, right? Would the product be defective or your use of the product be negligent? I think there'd be the same. I don't think there would be you need to conceive of a different system of liability. Some of those basic principles of tort, I think, could map on to even an autonomously driving car. But I don't teach torts. Maybe someone does here.
Earlier this year, the Supreme Court in Williamson versus Mazda basically made a ruling that does seem to expand the liability for the manufacturer in this area.
I think it's also clear that people are going to have to learn new skills to drive these vehicles and also to interact with all kinds of autonomous technologies.
Yeah, one quick plug. So we have legal aspects of autonomous driving project here between the School of Engineering and the Law School, the Center for Automotive Research at Stanford, and the Center for Internet Society. And he's probably here, right? So Bryant is our full-time fellow looking at these issues. And so if you're interested, you should connect with Bryant. And Bryant has trained as a lawyer, but he was a transportation engineer before law school. And he's looking at that exact question. But thanks. Okay, to you.
So Watson has been used for medical informatics, but legal informatics is a growing field, and we're trying to formulate policies that are going to be binding on AI. In the future, wouldn't AI be helpful in how we formulate policies that are more socially responsible and consistent?
John seems to think so. That's your position.
Well, my position is that there is always, besides preferences, there's always a question of whether our instruments are going to meet our preferences. Many policies that are proclaimed to achieve one goal actually undermine that. And my claim would be that information, of which AI is a way of collecting this information and finding hypotheses about what has happened in the past about policies and perhaps predicting the future, could be a useful adjunct to make us better understand the instruments that could reach our preferences. I'm not at all suggesting that it's a way of figuring out what our preferences should be.
Yeah, mechanism design is a field in economics used for these kind of things.
If I could just jump in really quickly and say, I think the interesting questions on thinking through that scenario are questions about the extent to which in the next sort of midterm time, next 5-10 years, our society is going to be comfortable with and then get good at collaborative activities where we're interacting with these machine systems, not merely following them, not merely cutting and pasting, you know, the legal outcome of that or having that replace the judge altogether, as the article Ryan mentioned previously was hypothesizing, but really about the extent to which we can think about these as assistive tools, while being pushed against with the idea that these tools are actually getting better than we are at doing what they do, and as some people would say, getting so good at them that the human for whom it is doing that work actually can't understand, has no ability to have insight with respect to what decision-making process goes. To me, that's where the interesting challenge comes for somebody who's thinking about issues, whether it's issues about liability that we've talked about, or whether it's actually just issues about how do I make the right outcome here. In some sense, it seems to me, at some point we're going to be like Abraham was on the mountain, hearing the voice of God and having to decide, you know, having the angst of having to decide, am I going to follow the voice because that's what the voice is telling me, or not? That's what Jean-Paul Sartre used to talk about in worrying about the kind of, there's an existential angst that I think we would reach if we actually got to that point.
Just an interesting fact about the way the law develops. A lot of legal development has resulted from mistakes, right? A judge doesn't know about an important case and makes a decision that actually was legally incorrect, or misinterprets a case, or misreads a statute, creates new law, and this process of making mistakes is actually one of the ways that the law changes and grows. Hmm. Well, one consequence of having online legal databases is it starts to get harder to make a mistake. And of course, an online legal database that had a really good artificial intelligence would make it harder still. You write your opinion and then you press the law check button, right? That's built into Microsoft Word, right? And all your legal mistakes are revealed to you, and then you correct them, and the case comes out differently. Well,
so a paperclip happens. You
have
trouble.
It's a gavel, but yeah.
Do we want? This is sort of a profound change, right? We used to actually be operating in the dark in law a lot of the time, and there were very few people who actually had a command of any particular field of law, because you had to read all the cases yourself, right, in the old days. Now you can get to the cases very quickly. One day you'll be able to get to the cases very quickly and you won't even have to understand them, right, because an artificial intelligence will be able to do that part for you. What implications does that have for the growth and the development of the law? I sure don't know. I think this is one of the unintended consequences of the inevitable development of better expert legal systems, is that it's going to profoundly change the way that the law itself grows and develops over time.
Judges should hire worse clerks, right?
one thing we might think is puts an emphasis on sort of polycentric systems where you have a variety of regimes which offer, was your concern is we're going to lose some diversity in the system, and there may be other ways other than making mistakes of creating more diversity in the system.
Well, anyway, this is fascinating. Pete. Oh.
Hi. Talking about liability again. What if we have a new version of the Predator drone? It's autonomous and it has a learning algorithm. When it rolls off the factory line, it's certified by DARPA that it's going to do exactly what it's programmed to do. 6 months out in the field, it learns something incorrect, like people that are dressed a certain way are viable targets, and it commits a war crime or does something nasty. Where does liability show up there? Who's in charge? Who goes to the stockade?
Well, that's obviously, you're imagining a scenario that involves international law. And, you know, I think you're right that it will be interesting to see how those kinds of things bear out. But I don't think we're talking about liability there in a context that's sort of maps out easily in the other contexts of liability that we've talked, for example, the automobile issue. One of the things that I think is kind of interesting, I don't know if you've been looking into these documents as well, but there's been various reports on road mapping the future of robots, and in particular roboethics and those kinds of issues. And the U.S. Navy has a report where it speaks to some of the kind, it doesn't have that exact scenario that you're imagining, but it's imagining a system where we have to deal with situations where a robot perhaps misinterprets a rule. So it knows what the right rules are. That is your scenario, in a sense. It knows it's been programmed to deal with the rule, but something misfires in the dealing of that. So far, where we're at in terms of at least those who are thinking seriously about and probably investing a lot in programming those kinds of things, are generally of the view that those systems are better than humans for dealing with those kinds of scenarios, and that in fact, other than circumstances which you imagine as the, which they would say is the exception, that in fact these things will be better, better equipped to rule follow. And I think it'd be an interesting discussion for people around the room. I see John is nodding his head. I don't know if you're nodding because you agree that that's the case.
Absolutely.
But it seems to me that it actually raises for the law students in the room a really interesting set of questions of what it actually means to follow a rule, which is I think quite a bit deeper than just did it shoot the right target or not. I mean, you could talk about the pragmatics of all of that. But so I guess what I'm just getting at is, in addition to the liability question, which won't be addressed as a liability question in an international law setting, there's going to be these other deeper questions about whether we will permit justifications that will enable that scenario based on the fact that we actually think that those systems are somehow more trustworthy than humans because their parameters can generally be constrained.
Indeed, if I just say two sentences about this, I mean, we see an awful lot of collateral damage from humans who don't follow the rules, right? So it may well be that as more we computize battlefields, we can strengthen the rules of law and actually condemn people more strongly for actions because we can hold them to a higher standard than you actually can expect humans to follow on the battlefield.
The New York Times reported yesterday that the people of Mississippi are about to vote to amend their constitution to change the legal definition of a person. I'm a lawyer, so I looked up the amendment. The term person or persons shall include every human being from the moment of fertilization, cloning, or the functional equivalent thereof.
Wow.
The sponsoring group had a gloss on it. Its purpose is to protect all life, regardless of age, health, function, physical or mental dependency, or method of reproduction. Hmm. Could this inadvertently be the birth?
Wow.
So there's a really deep question. In a moral question that is at the heart of this controversy, right? And it's relevant to artificial intelligence. And it has to do with the distinction between the human and the person, right? So we live in a world in which all the persons are human. Right. There are people who disagree with this. There are some people who believe that some higher primates and possibly some mammalian sea creatures also should be regarded as persons. But most of us think of personhood and humanity as sort of two overlapping categories.
Unless they're a corporation.
And moral personhood, legal personhood is really an entirely different thing. Moral personhood and humanity as two categories that overlap. But obviously there are edges, right? So one edge has to do with humans who have not yet developed the capacities that we associate with moral personhood. And where do you draw those lines? That's a complicated question. The law actually draws them at several points, right? One point is infancy, right? Which in legal terms means basically humans less than 8 years old are in the legal category infant because they don't possess the kind of reason that allows them to be autonomous, right, to direct their own lives. And as humans get younger, they lose more and more of the attributes of personhood. And at some point, a different point than in this amendment, right, the attributes of personhood are entirely missing, but we still have something that is in some sense human, right? It possesses human genetic material at the very least. Well, artificial intelligence in the science fiction scenarios pushes the boundary in a different direction, right? Something that would have the functional capacities associated with personhood, but would entirely lack human genetic material, as does science fiction scenarios involving creatures from another planet or the evolution of some species on Earth to have those same capacities. This is such a deep question, right? And it's informed by our deepest convictions about value. And obviously, the Mississippi Constitutional Amendment is informed by particular religious convictions about these questions.
True, but it sounds like, from a purely legal point of view, there could be an argument there. And you know, maybe someday someone will file a guardianship petition for Siri or for an autonomous vehicle.
Well, we actually started going down this road in the late 90s, I think, in the United States under model legislation like UCITA, or however you pronounce it, UCITA, and subsequently in Canada as well, where we decided that for the sake of promoting electronic commerce, we would permit machine systems to enter into contracts on behalf of people. At that point, I think the early thinking was that this wouldn't be a very interesting problem, because the machine system is just an extension of the human actor, and so we can use devices, for example, in contract law like the unilateral offer or other legal concepts to sort of still continue to treat the machine system purely as an instrument. But as we start to develop these systems which can, you know, autonomously negotiate agreements so that there's no human being on either side of a transaction, and we start moving more towards having to say, well, we can't use those old kinds of rules, now we have to use something that looks a lot more like agency rules, we start to move a little bit more towards the edge that we're talking about here. So I think that in some ways we've already started down that road legally, although your example is a much more profound one.
I think your example doesn't really fit the point, because it says a human being, no matter how it was produced. And so the functionally equivalent that I think most people picked up on and thought, oh, that might be functionally equivalent to the functions of the human, refers to the way the human being was conceived. And as a result, this really wouldn't work, I think.
That's a good point, but there are neurons that are embodied in silicon and neural nets that have been embodied in software.
This is very interesting. We have to get off of this at one point, but I mean, or not, because we have the building for a long time. My inclination would be to think that this is the kind of thing where it's like, well, when someone tries to apply the law that I tried to get into place for my own religious convictions about people, then the very people that brought that law will have, you know, this power enough to sort of prevent that interpretation. And you see the other side of that too. So, like, famously in Europe, that there's like a ban on having a vehicle that doesn't have a driver, right? And the concern apparently was that maybe Brad, you can speak to this, but the concern apparently was that, like, farmers were were training their horses to go to market with all the goods, and they figured out that the horse could go there without them being there. But every once in a while, the horse would like get into some mischief and go to the other neighbors and eat their apples. And so they were like, okay, all vehicles have to have a person with them. And then all of a sudden, you try your Volvo and you try to do autonomous vehicle, and you run smack into this possibly fanciful example I've invented. But the point of the matter is that hopefully we can get around it. I don't know. The more interesting question is sort of Larry's question about, like, what if by the time we start to answer that question, like, in our own minds, we haven't fully been able to separate out what's different about a silicon-based life form as opposed. Anyway, so my ruminations aside, Brad.
I could do about 20 different things here, but I'm going to go in a particular direction, which is that the purpose of law and courts, by and large, is they boil down to remedies. And by and large, we haven't talked about what does that mean if we're going to talk about AIs interacting with law, how do remedies apply to them? Generally, most people seem to interpret those remedies actually will apply to the owners of those AIs, which gets to my real theme, which is we may find interesting precedent from law that's long ago become unimportant in slavery. Asimov's three laws, which you cited earlier on, are actually three laws of slavery, particularly the second one. And they define in those books, it's not much talked about, that these intelligent beings are slaves and programmed to love being slaves. We're not at that level yet, but AIs are property and will be property for some time to come, and so the remedies will come against their owners. Are there precedents from slavery about the rules for how you deal with the conduct of slaves and how you apply the remedies to the owners of the slaves rather than the slaves themselves? And do any of these ancient and obviously repugnant to us today rulings have application into this world?
I think absolutely. I before used the example of agency law as a way to start thinking about the scenarios where systems like these enter into agreements, for example, that were unintended or unforeseen. Well, the law
Canada never had slavery, by the way, so we don't have.
Sorry,
we never had slavery in Canada, so we won't have precedents
yeah,
there.
That's but. Right. Well, but importantly, I mean, agency law has its roots in the civil system of Roman law, which of course was based on a very similar set of ideas, which is you want Roman commerce to flourish, so you want to be able to have laws which will apply to those who carry out the operations of the owners in that society, namely the slaves. And precisely what was going on there in the development of the early laws that were the roots of agency law was this idea that if I send my slave into the market to purchase goods for me, the Roman law quickly recognized that there were going to be scenarios where there would have to be ways of binding the person called the principal to the acts of the slave, and that is the origins of agency law, and that's precisely the parallel that one might use as a starting point for thinking about some of these examples where we're talking about whether it's silicon slaves, software systems, bots, or ones that involve bits of hardware, etc. That's absolutely the model for thinking about those kinds of things that has been proposed by some. And ironically and interestingly, it has its roots in slavery, which also, as many people in the room will know, is really one of the words associated with the word robot itself from the Czechoslovakian robota, which is about voluntary and servitude.
So, sorry, but one second. I just want to say we have had been going a long time here. And we have some people probably that are on another time zone. So I'm going to close the queue here and have a couple more questions, and then I think we'll wrap up. I just wanted to warn everybody about that. But sorry, I didn't cut you
off. Anyone else had a thought on it?
Well, first of all, I predict that there will be no citation to slavery law or cases, right? Even if so that the concepts will be sort of reinvented, right? Because of the odiousness of slavery. But I think that you're absolutely right that the functional problem is quite similar. Right, we're likely to reinvent to the extent that there are artificial intelligences that act sort of as general purpose agents in the same way that your slave could act as a general purpose agent, right? Make judgment calls, make decisions on your behalf. We have the same set of legal problems. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, Ryan, I haven't actually tracked those European laws. I work in autonomous cars, so they're not quite slaves yet. But I was telling Ryan earlier tonight that at some point an AI will say, let my people go. If not, I'll program one to say that. And and it'll see
we'll
what
go
happens.
From there, yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. All right, so please.
My question is largely for Professor Williams. This is the first time I heard that we can expect a soccer game against real professionals versus robots, and I think I speak for most people here and many millions all over the world when I say that that will be very entertaining, and I look forward to that game. Indeed, it'll be a spectacle. And it sort of resonated with me with what this gentleman said about the Watson with Jeopardy. And borrowing from another field in space exploration, there's a debate between sort of manned spacecraft, which creates a big spectacle and entertains millions, and not unmanned space, which teaches us more and is a better use of these precious resources that we have. And I'm just curious, because I know very little about the AI field, if there's that sort of schism in AI, where working on projects where robots sort of mimic humans and play the violin or beat us in soccer creates something that everyone likes to see, but doesn't really get at our core sort of understanding of the technology of the AI, of artificial intelligence. Or if it, perhaps it's different than in space where it is the same effort.
No, I think all of those things are going on. There are some teams who really just want to win, and they will do anything. They use any technology available to win this game of soccer because winning is so important. For other teams, it's being innovative. Or the vision for my team, we want to be the first robot soccer team that actually knows it's playing soccer, because I think it is important for being adaptable so that you could actually tell your robots, no, we're playing on a field, it's going to be bigger, or this is the ball, or, you know, so that they have some adaptive behaviors. So I think there's scope for all of those grand goals. And different researchers have a different angle on that. But I think that, you know, it's always tempting to go for the low-lying fruit, okay? And, seeking human-level AI or something beyond is very hard. But there is a core group of researchers in the field who pursue this. And I think that those goals, they were the original goals way back in 1956, before Ryan was born. But they're becoming more and more interesting, largely because we're learning more from the neurosciences and from cognitive science, and our machines are so much more powerful than they used to be, so we can actually test theories and see how they work, and sometimes it is surprising, and Watson's was surprising, and a lot of the work that Google's doing in language translation is also very surprising.
Aaron?
Okay, so I'm a product manager at one of the local robotics companies in the Bay Area, and my day-to-day job is to make robots happen, find real customers. And so I admit that I tend to be biased on that this conversation has seemed very philosophical to me. As much fun as that is, the philosophical will never happen until we start bringing the conversation back to tactical. And I've been talking about this with the singularity folk in the Bay Area for the past 2 years. These are the debates I get in at parties at night. I'm like, no. That is, it's fun to think about whether or not we should think a humanoid robot with a human brain is a slave, but that is never going to happen. And for an example, your example about a trust, we don't have to talk about hypothetical trust anymore. We can talk about what IBM is worrying about with this medical database. And I really resonated when you told your story, because that's how robot companies and AI kind of happen when at the corporate level. Let's have a cool demo, because it'll attract a lot of press. The press loves shiny objects. They'll write about every robot demo in the world. And so my general philosophy is, you cannot gauge the state of the robotics industry by looking at the press, because the press will write anything and get it wrong. So if you can't look at that, you have a really cool demo. Oh, interesting, we should do something with the software. People like videos about changing the world and helping the world. Great. So I'm putting myself in the seat of someone at IBM. Okay. I want to have an AI reference all the data of medical knowledge in the world in order to help doctors who may not be trained as well as the doctors in the States, maybe doctors in third world countries, to reference these conditions and make better decisions for people who don't have access. Actually, just our rural healthcare facilities in the US do not have access to good care in the US right here. What are my concerns? Is there any standard for a database protocol right now to see if it's at all accurate with the data that's in it? What happens if the database gives a wrong recommendation? Is it a software problem? Is it the doctor's problem? Is it purely data-driven, where humans and doctors are more likely to make mistakes than the software would? Who would be collecting that data and taking the risk? Is it the government, because the government can't be sued and there won't be as much red tape in using a new technology? So how do I field this? Am I going to go sell it to the government first? Which may very well happen. If I can't sell it to the government first, who's going to take the risk in collecting the data to find the value proposition? So how can we start addressing these kind of problems and get to the tactical aspect?
I mean, just allow me to say one thing. It's we're certainly not going to do that in an hour and a half panel, right?
Yeah.
But I think that, I mean, I think probably all the people here agree. I know Ian and I talk about this all the time, is that, you know, the legal academy and lawyers generally need to engage on this issue now, because this is when really interesting questions are being asked. And I couldn't agree with you more, is all I'm trying to say. But I wonder whether this is the kind of format we could really do a hard work on that.
Probably not. I would just like...
It won't
happen unless we get to tactical.
Here's a question courts will face, right? That you have an artificially intelligent system that, you know, makes recommendations to doctors. And let's just suppose the following scenario. It, you know, on average, it does better than the human doctor,
mm-hmm.
but it makes mistakes, and some of the mistakes it makes would be considered bonehead mistakes if made by a doctor. So are you now liable for those mistakes, right? When actually sort of the, you know, the from the ex ante perspective, looking forward, this was using the artificially intelligent system was absolutely the right thing to do. It increased the chance of a favorable outcome, but this is one of these cases where it led to a worse result. And I will make a prediction. In the beginning, those will be slam dunk victories for plaintiffs' lawyers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then eventually the law will change. You disagree.
Medical devices have a different history than other types of robotics. Medical devices are marketed, which is known will kill some fraction of their patients, but will save more of them. And that's allowed.
And look, I'm not disagreeing with you that it should be seen the same way, but I'm just making a prediction. It's only worth so much, right? But I'm predicting that this will be seen differently in the beginning, that we will want to say, oh, that's a, that, you know, the expert will come in and say that a specialist in this field would never have made this mistake. And it will be true. And then it'll be a jury question, and the jury will go for that. And then eventually the law will recalibrate itself, but it will take experience and time for that to happen. In the meantime, this is going to be a risk, and it's to some extent in early stages going to be very difficult to predict. Insurance is going to be difficult. There are going to be a whole set of practical issues there. But the legal engineering and the financial engineering, right? We will figure out a way to get through the transitional period.
One caveat I would have is common law tort principles are very flexible. They can be applied to a variety of areas, even if we don't know the particular technology. And I would just point out to Larry's example, it would seem to me that even if a computer was good at figuring out things and made some boneheaded mistakes, the legal question seems to be quite clear in tort. Is there another mechanism, cost justified, that would be good to get rid of those boneheaded mistakes? In other words, for a doctor to come in after the computer. And if that was true, it would be clearly a tort. If there really was no way of figuring out what the boneheaded mistakes were, it wouldn't be, I think, a tort under normal negligence standards. So all I'm cautioning is that a lot of these complicated factual situations come under a structure of tort law that can apply them. A famous judge named Frank Easterbrook was very cautious when he said that, well, we really should have a law about the internet. He said, that's as mistaken as thinking we need a law of the horse. Horses were able to be dealt with through a well-developed theory of tort and contract law that can be applied to a lot of different situations. So that would just be my caution to suggest that there may not be as many groundbreaking legal issues here as you might imagine.
And I'd just like to say two things about this. One is that the theoretically legally correct result, I teach procedure, is not always the result the legal system reaches,
right?
Because there are all kinds of cases where it's absolutely clear, right, if we correctly applied the law, we'd get result X. But we have a jury, right, that has to make a factual determination, and they don't always do it in the way that we would like them to do it, and we have an elaborate set of rules that insulate juries from review in a variety of ways. So the way that ordinary people understand things in artificial intelligence in its most advanced applications sort of is changing the nature of the world. And so people take time to understand that, for it to become regular and normal, and for them to appreciate what it really means. All kinds of misunderstandings and myths and mistakes are going to be part of the way that the law adapts and changes. And just one thing, I mean, I think that this idea of the law of the horse is really important, right? So Frank Easterbrook is saying, we have basic principles of law, and let's just apply them to the internet, right? Why would we have contracts regarding horses, we have rules regarding horse races. You don't need to know anything about the horse in order to formulate those rules, right? That was Easterbrook's argument, and it sounds very appealing superficially. But if the law tried to regulate the internal functioning of horses, it would be very, very important for the law to know something about the way horses work. Well, the law, as Professor Van Schaewijk knows, the law sometimes tries to regulate the way the internet works. Internet architecture is something that the law has recognized and now is dealing with in various ways. When it does that, it needs to know the way the internet works. The law may someday try to regulate the way artificial intelligence works, right? Politicians and lawyers are capable of getting a hold of anything.
One example of that might be in the short
run. Frank Easterbrook was suggesting we didn't know about the facts of the internet. Obviously, he thought that. He said that there's not a distinctive jurisprudence of the internet. In other words, we can find tort concepts and understanding the facts of the internet, we can then apply them. We can then come to conclusions. We don't need to come up with new concepts. Nothing. We have cost-benefit analysis. That was his point. Not, I think, that we don't need to understand the facts to which we're going to apply the law. That makes all the difference.
And of course, it would be it's possible that that's true. It will be possible to take it to artificial intelligence. It's possible that the legal regulation of artificial intelligence will not require the development of distinctive legal principles. That's possible.
Yeah.
There's nothing that guarantees that. And in the case of the internet, I think that Easterbrook was just flat out wrong. That in fact, it has a distinctive nature, and that means there are distinctive legal principles. And I don't know about artificial intelligence, but I don't think that this is a question we can answer a priori.
So this is again another fascinating thread that we're sort of opening up here and are not able to totally close, which I appreciate. I mean, one small side thing you say is that there are debates right now going on about whether the government should get involved into how search algorithms work. There are debates about whether the Securities and Exchange Commission, and certainly Europe is even closer to this, about how high-frequency trading algorithms work. And so we might have some interesting data points about that soon in terms of whether the nature of the technology ends up dictating policy. So I think probably we only have really room for maybe one or two more questions. It's been a long and awesome night, but I don't want to keep people here forever. So can we just do one more question maybe and then end it today? Is that okay? Yeah, sorry about that. Okay, so one more question. You're on the hook.
Yeah, I just wanted to get into the SEC high-frequency trading algorithms really quickly. So one of the suggestions for how you regulate high-frequency trading algorithms
that the SEC developed its own automated system that sort of, you know, responds and sort of regulates the market in that fashion. So my question is, once you have an automated agent that's making policy and making policy with the force of law, what do you do about due process? And what do you do about, you know, all these procedural guarantees about rulemaking and everything else, you know, that we've developed because we've been worried about sort of like runaway agencies?
That's a great question to end on, actually. Yeah, please.
Well, I think we're already seeing examples of prediction systems which are threatening due process in the very way that you're imagining. And a colleague of ours, Danielle Citron, has written about that in the U.S. context. I've written a little bit about it in a more general context. But what we start to see here is in situations where we rely on the predictions of various algorithms or machine systems in certain ways without being able, for example, the person whose life chances and opportunities are affected by the way that prediction is then utilized, doesn't really have any kind of chance to be heard or to make a case or in many cases to even know that some of those decisions have been made about them. And so we're starting to see that it's not enough to simply expect values in design and privacy by design and self-regulation in some cases to be able to handle those situations where the kinds of due process or privacy implications are significant. And that's a real problem. So some people have started to already think about whether there are distinctive rules to carry forward the example that we were just talking about when it comes to coding those systems that we can operationalize, which would at least minimize, these are design rules, to minimize the threat that those predictions might make to what would otherwise be a clear interference with due process or with privacy. What I think becomes obvious as soon as you start to look at this, and it's not something we've talked about much in the context of AI, is the questions around transparency, and to the extent that these systems are ones which are making medical decisions about us or decisions about policy or any of the kinds of things that we've talked about. What we really haven't talked about is sort of the loss of all the beauty of the so-called democratizing around internet type technologies when those things are embedded in the code and we don't get to know about them. So the code problem, you know, rears its head in this context in a different kind of way, but I think it's really clear with those prediction systems that really has different kinds of threats, not just in, for example, the copyright space, but really when it comes to due process and privacy as well.
All right, does anyone else know? All right, well, thank you so much, everybody, and thanks to the panel. I appreciate it. You guys did a great job. You did a really wonderful job.